This is the Bax and Grant Sports Show presented by Sports Radio America. I'm Bax.
And this is Grant.
Grant, wait, what did I just say, Grant? We're presented by Sports Radio America. Is that right?
Yes, that is correct. We just got picked up by them a couple days ago.
Yep. We have officially signed all our T's, crossed our T's, dotted our I's, and we are officially a part of the Sports Radio America network. The official crossover, Grant, will happen on Monday, though, where you'll be able to tune into SportsRadioAmerica.com. They broadcast all of their episodes of shows that they have on their network on TuneIn Radio. You can find them on iTunes Radio, as well as Live 365 Radio. And we'll be on there. We'll be on there Monday, Wednesday, Friday, even though we will still be here available on Spreaker for you to catch us, as well as on Facebook. But you will also be able to tune in and hear us and hear the show several times,
right.
Monday, Wednesday, Fridays, which is a huge thing. So we are very, very excited about that. I know that we were kind of caught off guard by their offer and everything, but everything really lined up, and we're really looking forward to building the show as a whole, and we're very thankful to Sports Radio America and everyone at that organization for giving us an opportunity for a show, Grant, that really kind of started off just as a joking thing between us, like,
right.
We should do this, and
right.
They're like, maybe not, but seriously,
right,
we
right.
should do this. And then,
yeah. But I'm so glad that you did that, because look when it all started.
Your face when I was like, Grant, we should do a show. You're like, sure, we should. And I was like, but really, though, we should.
But yeah, like Baxter said, we'll still be here on Spreaker at 9 a.m. Monday, Wednesday, Friday. We're still not quite sure. It's not official yet exactly what times it's going to be over at over there. But we'll get that information to you as soon as we find out. We were maybe playing around with middle of the day, but we're still not sure yet, so we'll keep you updated on that.
Yeah, from everything we've been told, they're making it sound like we will be your lunchtime entertainment for you, whether it's like that 11 to 2 slot or that 12 to 3 slot. And we would love to have a three-hour show, but at the same time, Grant and I both go to college full-time, and he has a child, and we work, et cetera, et cetera. So what you'll be hearing during that time, if you do tune in, will be the show that we do in the morning at 9 a.m., just that 45-minute show that we do, just on repeat. So it'll play about three times throughout the course of the time that we would be on the air for them. But even still, it's a great way for us to build our brand, for our recognition. Grant, we got to go take some more official photos, I feel like, with
yeah.
us. And really, stop looking like a bunch of college guys, Grant. We got to start working our professional aspects of it. So once again, though, we are very excited about this opportunity. And remember to check us out on Facebook. You can like the Bax and Grant Sports Show Facebook page. We've had a few more recent likes in the past few days. So thank you very much to all of you out there. More followers on Twitter as well. Check us out at BG Sports Show. And remember, you can download the podcast as well on Spreaker, but also on iTunes as well. So we are all over the place and are continuing to grow our brand as we continue on this exciting journey. Grant, yesterday it was National Signing Day for all of the high school players looking to make the jump to college football. A lot of really interesting stories coming out of them, but none more interesting than Katy Perry's left shark. Katy Perry's left shark apparently is committed to play for the University of Boise State. Now, I don't know exactly how credible that is, but there was a tweet from Boise State University yesterday with a picture of the dancing little, the left, you know, backup dancer shark from Katy Perry's halftime show that said, you know, left shark is committed to play at Boise State. But it's funny how the left shark has created such a presence.
Right.
And I mean, he was just, I didn't think he did all right at the Super Bowl. I didn't think
right.
he was that noticeable, though, that people are making as big a deal about him as they are.
I think it's people of the internet just being weird. And like, I saw some pictures of that and I'm like, what about the right shark?
No.
What happened to the right shark?
I think everybody he should
sue. Yeah, everybody just forgot about him. He did the exact same thing as the left shark, only mirrored.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, But yeah, I mean, why are we talking about this? This is a sports radio show, Baxter. I mean, come on.
I know,
come
sorry,
on.
But it's,
come
a, on. It's an exciting time. This is how I'll rationalize it. He was a part of the Super Bowl, which is sports.
All right.
And yesterday was National Signing Day. Sports. And then he's playing quote unquote football at Boise State. Sports. Ha! Three credible sources, Grant. Come at me.
Yeah, credible sources.
I
there
mean,
you go.
Katy Perry, she's pretty credible.
Definitely credible.
I'm not doubting her credibility one bit. Good news for the Packers. They have found a new special teams coach.
Oh,
Sean Slocum, as you know, was released.
Right.
AKA, he was fired. Okay, he was
good
fired.
Good riddance.
He wasn't released in terms of just like, you know, Sean, things really aren't working out. It's not you, it's me. It was, you fired, like Donald Trump fired. But whatever. They seem to have found their new man. The name being thrown around the Packer world is Ron Zook. He was promoted from within the organization.
Expected to be promoted.
He's expected to be promoted, but everything that we are hearing and seeing, courtesy of Pro Football Talk and Packers.com, is that he will be the man promoted from within the organization. He was an assistant under Sean Slocum at the Green Bay Packers, but then he also had a stint with the Panthers as well. So now it looks to be that he is the front runner to replace Sean Slocum. And it's interesting because I was listening to Homer and Gabe yesterday, Grant, on ESPN Milwaukee, and they were talking about how special teams coaches are usually one of the next candidates to replace a head coach once they're fired, because it's one thing to be an offensive coordinator. That's all you know is the offense. It's one thing to be a defensive coordinator. It's all you know is the defense. Special teams, you need to know everybody because you know the top and the bottom of the roster, because special teams is a combination of offensive and defensive players on kick coverage, on punt return, on all of that. So a special teams coach really knows the ins and outs of a single team in a very impressive way.
Right.
So obviously I don't see McCarthy retiring anytime soon. But
no.
You look at a guy, and this is something I didn't know, that John Harbaugh was a special teams coach before he became a head coach.
Really? That's interesting.
So I found that out.
It makes sense, though, too. And what you're saying with the offensive defensive thing, just look at the Packers, at least their punt returning at the beginning of the season. And last season, it was Randall Cobb. And now, and like later towards the end of the season, it changed to Micah Hyde. They play both sides of the ball.
Yeah.
So, yeah, like you said, they have to know both offensive and defensive. And I never thought about that before. That's very interesting.
Yeah,
that
I didn't really put that two and two together as well, but you know, special teams is a forgotten art in that regard. So there's so much that goes into it, and football really is a three-stage game. Your offense, defense, and special teams all needs to click at the same time, especially like what happens when it comes to winning a Super Bowl. All three phases of the game need to show up all at once, otherwise there's really no chance of your team winning. And some teams like Seattle can get away with having a decent offense, a great defense, and a pretty good special teams, hence the reason they made it that far. Obviously,
right.
They rode their defense into the ground to get them to the Super Bowl, as we see most often, or vice versa. Even the Broncos last year, they made it to the Super Bowl because of Peyton Manning and the offense. Green Bay, they're getting to that pretty level across the board, but now with Sean Slocum gone, they're working on this potential new guy, Ron Zook. They might actually have a good three stages of the game. And obviously the defense is not at the same level that the offense is at yet for the Packers, but...
Right, but it's better.
It's
better than it has been in the last couple of years.
Yes.
And that's all you can really expect. And this is kind of changing topics, but people all throughout the season was still saying that the Packers' defense was bad, and yada, 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 this, that, and the other thing. My thing to that is you obviously did not follow them this season. If you want to compare their defense to what it was the last couple of season, it is night and day almost. I mean, not all the time. You would still see some of the defense that we have seen in the last couple of years, but overall...
Atrocious, I think, is a good word for
atrocious
how to describe
is
the Packers' defense.
Yeah, but this season, they improved. And anybody who says that they were bad this year, I don't really necessarily agree with you.
Yes. Which happens. You don't agree with a lot of things that people say, Grant.
No, I don't.
Hence the reason you have your rants, so you can trash people. Well, you don't do it to trash people, but you do it to get your point across and be heard.
Right.
Another thing, too, Grant, just one more thing that's been a focal point, even though the Super Bowl was a few days ago, it was 3 days ago already, seems like it was a year ago for some reason in terms of how fast the sports world moves. But the one thing people are still holding on to, which is funny, I have not heard a single thing about Deflategate since the Super Bowl. So thank God.
Thank the Lord.
Yes, we can sing his praises. We will have a chapel choir in here later to sing his praises about that. But everyone is still having an issue with the final play of the Seattle Seahawks in terms of Russell Wilson throwing the interception that Malcolm Butler immaculately jumped that route. That was the pass was intended for Ricardo Lockett and intercepted the ball. People are still having an issue with because everyone is saying, why would you not give the ball to Marshawn Lynch? You're on the 1 yard line. Give the ball to Marshawn Lynch. He is beast mode. He has got 36 inches, literally 36 inches from where the tip of the ball was to the end zone. Pretty sure Marshawn Lynch could have gotten in, is what people are saying. But you have a guy like Russell Wilson, the man that threw the unfortunate interception, coming out and continually saying that he had no doubt in the play call, and he said that I still don't to this day.
But now if he doesn't say that, what does it say with his relationship with Pete Carroll?
Exactly.
And the media coming out saying, oh, now there's trust issues in the program, it's going downhill, then it takes people off in the organization. So, I mean, he had to say that pretty much. And unless he did have a problem with Pete Carroll, the organization, then he can just lay into them. But that's not he's a team-oriented person, which I respect him for that. And so he's not going to come out and say anything really negative about the play call.
No, he's too nice of a guy to do that.
Right. And I don't necessarily agree with the play call. I'm with the people that said they should run it in. I think that's the majority of the people. But their defense for picking the play call or for picking pass plays on first and second down and then running in on third and fourth down, I agree with that because mm-hmm. they were saying that or I can see where they were coming from because they saw the Patriots set up in a goal line formation and so they were going to try a pass and they felt like with their ability they'd be able to get it in the end zone. And like we talked in the past show, the space from the defender and the receiver when Russell Wilson was throwing the ball mm-hmm. was a good couple yards. And he even said that he thought that when I was watching an interview, he thought they won when he let go of the ball.
Yeah.
Because he thought it was going in. And then the defender comes out of nowhere. So it wasn't even like Russell Wilson made a bad play. It was just a fantastic defensive effort. But also another interesting thing that I did find was somebody simulated the Super Bowl on Madden 2015.
Yep.
And got to the same exact spot, like the time was off by 8 seconds, but that doesn't matter. And they ran it in with Marshawn Lynch.
Yep.
Marshawn Lynch wasn't even touched.
No. But they used a different formation though. I did notice that. They used an I formation instead of a single back formation, which the Seahawks used. Either way, continue.
But then you could have changed the play call to something in an I formation.
Yes.
But see, that it's a whole bunch of what ifs and this, that, or the other thing. What would happen if they did this? And my personal opinion, they would have had a couple opportunities to knock it in with Marshawn Lynch. And you can even expect Marshawn Lynch to most of the time get to the line of scrimmage.
Oh, yeah.
So if he doesn't even get it in the end zone, you're not losing yards or anything. Or maybe if a defender gets in the backfield and you get tackled and maybe now you're on the 3rd or 4 yard line, now you have a little bit of space maybe to throw the ball. So I would have went with a run, but I do respect their play calls, but I do think it did lose them the Super Bowl.
Yes, yep, and that play call will go down in history of the Super Bowl and Pete Carroll's career as a whole, too, saying that if he had just called a run, he would be sitting with his second Super Bowl ring, and Russell Wilson would be hallowed as one of the best quarterbacks to ever play in the Super Bowl. Yeah, well, who knows? Either way, Grant, we're going to move on to some sports that are a little bit more near and dear to us on the next segment. You're going to talk a little hockey. I'm going to talk a little bit of soccer. Connor Christensen joins us later in the show to talk about Josh Gordon and some other fitness tips. This is the Bax and Grant Sports Show. Don't go anywhere. Satisfy me, baby. Baby, close your eyes and listen to the music. Dig to the summer breeze. It's a groovy night and I can show you how to use it. To come along with me and put your mind at ease. Hey! A little less conversation, a little more action. All this aggravation ain't satisfying.
A little more bite, a little less bark. A little less fight, a little more spark. Shut your mouth and open up your heart. And baby, satisfy me. Satisfy me, baby. Come on, baby, I'm tired of talking. Grab your coat and let's start walking.
Welcome back to the Bax and Grant Sports Show, presented by Sports Radio America. I'm Bax.
And this is Grant.
Are you sure?
I
feel like
we've done?
We've had this conversation.
Are you done?
I just want to make sure that, you know, somebody didn't sneak in the show during the commercial break and
club me over the head, drag me off, put on all my clothes, makeup, just like me, sound exactly like me, in the matter of the 2 seconds that you weren't looking.
Have you heard of Frank Caliendo?
No,
he sounds like a lot of people. he could really he could sneak in here and do just about anything. But Grant, speaking of clubbing, talk a little bit about hockey that's going on in the NHL. People love to hit each other.
Yeah, is that how you're tying it over?
Sure,
clubbing.
That's my segue into hockey, Grant.
All right,
give us a rundown of what's going on in the NHL. Give us a little bit about your Blues and all that jazz.
All right, so I'll give the two top teams of each division. In the Atlantic Division, Tampa Bay is up with 69 points, 32 wins, 15 losses, 5 overtime losses. Montreal Canadiens, 32 wins, 15 losses, 3 overtime losses with 67 points. In the Metropolitan Division, the New York Islanders are having a fantastic season with 32 wins, 17 losses, only 1 overtime loss with 65 points, and the Pittsburgh Penguins with 28 wins, 14 losses, and 8 overtime losses with 64 points. Now that's in the Eastern Conference, and now in the Western Conference, which are actually doing surprisingly better in the past couple years. It's been the Eastern Conference that is just having fantastic seasons, and the Western Conference is about, I would say, about 8-10 points behind.
Which is funny too, Grant, because in a lot of other sports, you look at the East and West conferences, and it's usually the Western Conference in most sports.
Right.
You look at the NBA, you look at NFL, even MLS soccer too. The West is usually miles ahead of everybody on the East, but so it's interesting, like you said, that the East is really making a name for themselves this season.
Right, but I will continue now with the Western Conference. Nashville Predators are atop the Central Division with 33 wins, 11 losses, 6 overtime losses with 72 points. The St. Louis Blues are in second place with 33 wins, 13 losses, and 4 overtime losses with 70 points. And in the Pacific Division, Anaheim is up 33 wins, 12 losses, 6 overtime losses with 72 points. And the San Jose Sharks are far behind with 61 points with 27 wins, 17 losses, and 7 overtime losses. Now, I'm going to head over to ESPN's power rankings, and they have Nashville and St. Louis, which are the Central Division 1 and 2. Now, Nashville is 1, St. Louis is 2. Like I said, Nashville's 32, 11, and 6. And they're actually doing surprisingly well. They beat the Penguins 4-0. And
which is no easy feat.
No, not at all. And it's especially because Pittsburgh Penguins, that's Sidney Crosby and yep. Malkin. I can never pronounce his first name.
Evgeny?
Evgeny Malkin.
It's my soccer background. I'm used to pronouncing weird names. Anyway, continue.
Well, I mean, hockey, they got some weird
names.
Well,
yeah, but how come I can say it and you can't?
I don't know. I'm used to Shattenkirk and all
Shattenkirk.
That.
Oh, man.
But anyway, and what's another surprising thing for Nashville is that they're all-star goalie Pekka Rinne is out with injury.
Bless you.
Oh, yeah, thank you. And he is out for injury, and he played fantastically last night. He had a ridiculous save where the puck deflected, and it was about to go in, and he did like a 180 stick kick, or I don't even know. He just swatted the puck out with a stick after doing
wow.
a 180 spin. It was absolutely ridiculous. So Nashville, power ranking number 1. St. Louis is right behind them. They were last week they were ranked number 1. They dropped a spot. That's probably because they just lost, like I said a couple seconds ago, Kevin Shattenkirk. they just lost him to, I think, a season-ending injury. I looked for details, but it looked pretty serious from what I was looking at, so He's probably gone for the rest of the season with an abdominal injury. Mm. But in their last 11 games, they have 10 wins with one overtime loss.
Wow.
That is ridiculous.
That is incredible.
So they're just on a tear right now. They're one of the best teams in the NHL. They didn't have the best start of the season, so doing this is fantastic. Now, the biggest surprise for me right now, that they have just come up. They did not have another good start of the season. They haven't had a good couple seasons, is the Detroit Red Wings, excuse me.
A team that is usually very solid and consistent throughout NHL.
They used to be a couple, I would say about 5 seasons ago, they always used to be competitors, but the last couple of seasons, they have not put together decent teams. I don't even think they made the playoffs last year. And I apologize if I'm wrong, but they didn't make it very far if they did.
Is Steve Yzerman still on the team?
I don't know.
Okay.
Because I don't follow the Red Wings
that
specifically. I just follow them as a team.
Okay. He was one of my favorite players to have on backyard hockey back in the day. Steve Yzerman from the Detroit Red Wings. That's the only reason I knew who the Red Wings were.
I don't think they do. I think the only older guy that they still have on there is Pavel Datsyuk, because a lot of their guys have moved on. Yeah, but the Wings have won 12 of their last 16, and they are tied with the Canadiens and are only a point back from the Lightning.
Mm.
So they're performing very well after the All-Star break. So that's a big surprise for me to see them.
Sure, yep.
And the Tampa Bay Lightning are in the fourth spot with 32-15-4, and I feel like that's a little bit of a drop for them. I feel like they should be a little bit higher because, in my opinion, they are the best team in the NHL right now, over Nashville, St. Louis, and Detroit. That's just my personal opinion.
Of course. Everyone's entitled to their own opinion, Grant.
Right. And then Anaheim's down here at the fifth spot, which is also surprising. I would also expect them to see them up there, but they're tapering off a little bit. What are you guys talking about?
You're just laughing at me.
I'm
not laughing at you. I am reacting to your passion for this and just having a good old time here, which is great. It's amazing because it's funny. You can go on and talk about hockey extensively for hours.
Right.
And I can do the same thing for soccer, and we'd be switching spots, and you'd be looking at me like, nobody knows exactly what's going on. So it's funny. It's cool to see your passion for hockey shine through, and everything. So I'm not making fun of you at all. I promise. It's cool to see that. It's kind of a classic case too of that. America is such a one or two league sport specific following. You usually follow an NFL team 9 times out of 10. And then usually you follow one more league after that. That's just kind of how the average American does that. Usually it's just an NFL team because most people don't have time to follow everything else. But hockey is just something I never got into.
Right.
Just never got around to getting into it, even though living in the Midwest most of my life, even when I lived down in Florida too, we've got several hockey teams down there. But it's funny to see how people raised in the same general area of the country came up with two completely different views on sports. So
right.
It's cool though.
All right, well, thank you.
You're really laughing at me, like, what are they going on about? Not at all.
Yeah, but anyway, I think Anaheim should be up there a little bit, even though they've lost their last couple of games. I don't think that's anything too major for them. I don't see them not making the playoffs at all. They're still a top competitive team. With only 12 regulation losses, I think that's not too shabby, so I do think they should be up there a little higher. What is surprising, though, is that the Boston Bruins are up in the 7th spot, and with just 2 regulation losses in their last 17 games. Now, that is incredible, especially they had an awful start to their season.
That's right, yeah.
So for them to be getting back to this point, it's great. I remember at the beginning of the season, the Blues were doing better than the Bruins. They still weren't doing great, but they were doing better than the Bruins. And I have a friend that is a Bruins fan.
Ooh.
And I was like, so how are those Bruins doing this year? And he's like, don't talk about it. I don't want to talk about it.
One of those things, you just don't talk about the Bruins.
Right. But they're 27-16-7. They're back in the hunt of things, even though they're still kind of buried in the Atlantic Division. They're in fourth place, it behind the Red Wings, the Canadiens, and Tampa Bay. But if they keep on playing like they have been, with only two regulation losses in 17 games, I see no problem with them catching up.
I still find it funny. And we're back. So, Toronto Maple Leafs. I don't understand how a team from Canada can not be doing that well.
Well, because it's not strictly Canadian players.
I know. But as an outsider looking, it's like, but they're from Canada. That's all they do is play hockey.
Hey, they curl. They curl. They have feelings.
Well, they
got
to get outside. Curlers, they got to get out of the curling area and get into the hockey area. You're in seventh place, Maple Leafs. Get it together.
I would also like to make it known to everyone that I played hockey and curling, so I can expect.
Well, see, Grant, I was only a curler and a soccer and a hockey player. Please, I can barely skate around the rink. I played soccer and football, but I did do curling, so you can't hate on me too much, hockey fans, especially Canadians. But anyway, Grant, it's time for your rant. Are you ready to spew some wonderful information about the sports world on us?
Oh, I am ready.
All right, it is time for Grant's rant. All right, Grant, for those that don't know, this is the part of the show where you come out and sing a silly song. No, just kidding. This is the time of the show where you come out and talk about something in the sports world. And you just don't care, Grant.
I just don't care.
You just throw it at us, and we have to love it or list it. Wait, that's HGTV. I'm just confusing all kinds of shows today. Holy cow. All right, Grant, 30 seconds on the clock, and begin.
All right, Lance Armstrong apparently hit two parked cars with his SUV after a night of partying, then later lets his girlfriend take the blame for it. She later then tells police that she lied about it, but we don't know if it was he told her to lie or if she just lied. But honestly, after all his steroid and blood doping stuff and cheating, he doesn't need more bad press, so why he did this, I don't know.
Time's up. Wow. Who would have known? A biker. He rides a bike, for gosh sakes. He doesn't play football or hockey or any other sport that can cause a lot of bodily damage to somebody, but who knows? That's just kind of how the sports world works nowadays. Tiger Woods, he's a golfer. He plays golf, and his wife almost beat him upside the head with a golf club. Anyway, we're going to take a quick break. When we come back, Connor Christensen's in the studio. We're going to chat about Josh Gordon, Johnny Manziel, and we're going to play a little What If with him, and he is going to offer his health tip of the day. This is the Bax and Grant Sports Show. Don't go anywhere. I wipe my brow and I sweat my rust. I'm breathing in the chemicals. I'm breaking in, shaping up, then checking out on the prison bus. Welcome back to the Bax and Grant Sports Show, presented by Sports Radio America. I'm Bax, and I know that you're Grant.
Okay, good. At least you know this time.
Yes, and Connor Christensen is here as well. Welcome, Connor.
Hello, thanks for having me.
All right, so, Connor, the reason we've asked you to be on the show today, aside from your aura that you do spew upon the rest of us, we asked you here today because we want, as a health professional, you're studying athletic training, you've got an extensive background in sports and exercise science. There's a lot of issues going on right now with two particular players in the NFL, specifically Josh Gordon and Johnny Manziel. Now, Johnny Manziel was considered one of the best quarterbacks to ever play in college football. He just was an amazing player to watch on the field, but off the field he had a lot of issues with alcohol, selling things in terms of, you know, with his autographs on them. And then we look at Josh Gordon, a man that was suspended for most of the season this last year in terms of having drug-related issues, and now he has officially been suspended for the 2015 NFL season without pay because of violating the alcohol policy. As somebody that would be on the sidelines, per se, with the teams, with the players. What kind of effects do the issues that Manziel and Gordon are putting their bodies through affect how they would play the game from a physical and nutritional standpoint?
Well, I had heard that they do marijuana as well. Is that
yes,
correct?
Yes, yep. No, Gordon did marijuana. I don't know. We can assume Manziel did it. But.
Okay. Well, to start with alcohol, the technical term for a substance like alcohol would be a depressant. So that is something that depresses the immune system and the central nervous system. So what that means is your body is not as capable of fighting off infections. Mm. So where your body would be able to fight off a common cold, Josh Gordon's wouldn't because he's, you know, drinking all day. Johnny Manziel is over there sniffling on the bench because his body can't fight off infection. when I say it depresses the central nervous system, that means that the body cannot manage itself as well. So people who are alcoholic usually have a depression that goes along with that. They usually have anxiety disorders, so like panics, things that normal people
do not
suffer from on a daily basis.
Sure.
So when you're sitting on the sideline and you need to have and you want more alcohol, you want more marijuana, you get this kind of an anxiety for it. You can get a twitch with it. So especially for like a quarterback, you know, something like that would be not good at all.
No.
Your decision making is significantly impaired. So do I need to cut right, cut left, or am I running north to south? As a quarterback who is on the run suddenly, you're going to run right into Clay Matthews and he's going to murder you.
Yes.
Josh Gordon, when his reaction time would be slower significantly if he's doing drugs and marijuana. So his ability to catch the ball is no longer as good as it normally would be. Those are kind of just the base,
sure, yeah, the base idea of it. Now, on the flip side of it, Grant, from a not as scientific perspective, ESPN senior writer Jeremy Fowler basically came out and said that this is more than likely not just the end of Josh Gordon, not only in Cleveland, but potentially in the NFL as a whole. Is that true, or is some team going to still be like, but Josh Gordon is a really, really good receiver? And we even had him as consideration for our all-USA team when we were talking about if there was a World Cup of football.
Right. We said that if he shaped up.
If he shaped up. This, we made sure to specify if he shaped up.
And this is clearly not him shaping up.
No.
Now, firstly, I think this is indefinitely the end with him and the Browns. The Cleveland Browns are trying to rebuild their organization from the past years of failure. They had a decent season last year. They were pretty close to making the playoffs. And they don't need this kind of negative press. They've had negative press all throughout the years. They just don't need this from a player. They gave him multiple chances. This is his third suspension.
Yep.
I think he's done.
Three strikes, you're out, especially in Cleveland. In the NFL, it's hard to know for sure if another team wouldn't be desperate enough to go sign him. I could see him ending up in the bad boy capital of the NFL, a.k.a. Oakland. But at the same time, it's not exactly sure to know where he will end up. So it'll be interesting to see where he lands in that regards. But moving aside from that, Cleveland, they finished at the bottom of their division last season. They were finished 7-9, although they were very much in the playoff hunt for a while. But three out of the four teams in the AFC North went to the playoffs.
Right.
So it's hard to really know for sure if Cleveland is even going to be a playoff contender with teams like the Bengals and the Steelers and Baltimore. I don't know. I think Cleveland still has a long way to go. There's been rumors about the Browns maybe drafting another quarterback just to kind of hit the reset button. But at the same time, the fact that Manziel has checked himself willingly into rehab, knowing that he has a problem. We've heard about other NFL players in the past getting opportunities to restart, go to rehab, kind of hit the reset button on their career, and then come out better, not only men because of it, but also better players as well. So we'll see exactly what happens with that. Connor, you've got your fitness/health tip of the day for our listeners. This is something we're going to try to continue to do on the show, hopefully on a weekly basis when you stop by. We obviously enjoy your commentary on the Minnesota Vikings, which is a big deal for you as a Vikings fan. But then since you are our sport and exercise science guru, we do prefer you also sharing a little bit of your passion as well. So take it away, sir. You have the floor.
Well, first of all, I just want to start out by saying that I am in my fourth year of sport and exercise undergraduate study in college. So, and then after this, I plan on going for athletic training. So a lot of ambition after this. It's gonna be great. But so my fitness tip for the day is visualization, which is interesting. You wouldn't necessarily think of that as...
Like with your eyes, visualization?
Sometimes.
Okay.
I'm going to say it's a goal. It's a way of thinking. It's a focus for your training. So when you are training for a track and field long distance run, maybe the mile or the 2 mile, the days before this and even directly before this, you are supposed to sit down, calm yourself, visualize the race happen. And because whenever people run those races, it is tiring. Those races are by far some of the hardest races there are in track and field. So you have to visualize yourself pushing beyond your limits. You visualize yourself not giving up before the actual race. So when the race actually comes, your mind is willing to push yourself. Another thing, Baxter, you and I have experienced this when conditioning days in soccer, they're the worst. You need to have a reason to run. Otherwise, you will
to survive.
You will.
That's the reason I run, to survive.
You will give up if you do not have some motivation for running. So find something that drives you to
my
keep
mother.
Playing. Baxter's mother.
I love my mother. I run for you, Mama.
Shout out to Mama. Anyway. Yeah. And then also, when you're weightlifting, when you're trying to build muscle for your training, that's when I was talking about with focus. If you're doing a bench press, you focus on the chest working, because a lot of times people say, oh, I feel it in my arms or I feel it in my shoulders.
Speaking to me when you say in your shoulders.
What?
I don't understand.
No,
well, no. I, when we were lifting the other day, I said the same thing.
Thank you. It's not me.
No, I know.
But then he said, imagine pushing it out with your chest, and that's where you want your power to be coming from. I did that, and I felt my body working a lot more efficiently. Mm-hmm. And
yeah,
it wasn't necessarily easier, but it kind of was in a way. It, like, spread out the workload. And it was more focused. Like, I focused, like, imagining pushing it out with my chest, and it did become, like, my body worked a lot more proficiently when I did that.
It doesn't become easier, but it does become more focused on what you're trying to do.
Interesting.
So,
like
having your Grant here, you're backing up my
point. You're welcome.
Which
is good. It's a good example. Yeah, Connor Christensen, the official trainer of the Bax and Grant Sports Show. That's how we have these very sleek radio bodies.
Because
of Connor.
Yeah,
right?
Perfect radio body.
Grant has a face for radio. I don't even know what I have, but. All right, well, Connor, we appreciate that. We do want to keep you on the rest of the show with just a little bit of time left to play What If with us. So the way that What If works is we will present a What If scenario. And the way that is we used an example last week or last time of what if Brett Favre never left the Packers the first time? What if he stayed in Green Bay and finished off his career, etc.? So, Grant, you have the floor. Keep it short and sweet, and Connor and I will react to your question, then we'll go from there. So, floor is yours.
All right, I'm going to take the big general one.
Please.
As, what if the Seattle Seahawks
here we go.
Ran it on the 1 yard line instead of making the controversial pass call?
My faster answer to that was that they would have scored. We would have been talking about the Seahawks winning the Super Bowl, and I think Russell Wilson would still be considered horribly overrated.
At least by us.
At least by us, yes. The defense bails him out a lot. Connor, your reaction?
I do believe that they would have scored, and they would have won the Super Bowl. And I think that ESPN, the NFL, would be all over the Patriots for Deflategate.
Oh yeah.
I feel like that would have been brought up right away again, and the Patriots would have been under severe scrutiny for quote-unquote cheating.
Yes. Okay. Connor, what is your what-if scenario?
My what-if scenario, I apologize in advance. You guys are going to hate me for this one. What if Aaron Rodgers and Jordy Nelson connected in the first quarter of the NFC Championship this year?
I can answer that
in the end zone.
I can answer that very simply. We would have gone to the Super Bowl, and it's hard to say what would have happened in the Super Bowl because we were kind of tailing off. They were kind of tailing off towards the end of the season. I would say we could have put up a they could have put up a fight in the Super Bowl, and I could say possibly getting a win, but I'm not going to be extremely biased. I'm going to be honest and say it was a would be a fairly hard game to win, but I would give them a fair chance in it. But we would have definitely won. They would have definitely won the NFC Championship game.
Okay. My reaction to that is I think that it wouldn't. There was still too many other things that needed to have gone right in that game for the Packers to win the game convincingly. That would have certainly helped, but with all of the other minor issues that happened in that game, it's hard for me to really say that, well, even if they would have scored, they would have won the game. So I can't give a full answer on that one because there were still enough little things that helped contribute to the overall aspect of them losing the game.
Well, my rebuttal to that would be, okay, yeah, but then they would have had 7 more points that would have been a little less momentum going to the Seahawks saying we have this much to overcome. One more touchdown would be like would maybe even put it a little bit too far out of reach for them.
Okay, and then my what if to both of you gentlemen, since you hit close to home for us, we're going to hit close to home for you, Connor. What if Adrian Peterson does not have any of the issues come out this last season with him and his son? Do the Vikings make the playoffs?
Do the Vikings make the playoffs?
They finished 7-9 without him.
So that is a very interesting question because when you have a running back like Adrian Peterson, you don't need to rely on the quarterback as much. So my big question comes, does Teddy Bridgewater see the field? Because they had no intention of playing him. They were going to play Matt Castle. So if Matt Castle still gets injured, I could see Teddy Bridgewater taking the field again. But if I will say they make it as far as they did with one or the other.
Okay.
If you have both, I think, yes, they make it to the playoffs.
Okay. Grant, quickly with the time remaining.
I would say that they would not make it to the playoffs, but they would have a 500 or above 500 record.
Interesting. Okay. And I was looking through their schedule a few different times, and I think that there were at least 3 games they could have won almost easily, but the tides didn't go their way, unfortunately, at the end. So, Connor, thank you so much for stopping by. It's been a distinct pleasure, as it always is with you. Grant, as always, a pleasure as well. Make sure to check out the show on Friday. This has been the Bax and Grant Sports Show, presented by Sports Radio America. Have a good rest of your day, and we will see you all on Friday.